Okay, students, we have discussed till question number 54. So today we will discuss from question number 55. Okay, question number 55. Question number 55 also we discussed. That is all of the above. Question number 56. In the electron transport system present in the inner mitochondrial membrane, complexes 1 and 4 respectively. Options: NADH dehydrogenase and FADH2, FADH2 and NADH dehydrogenase, NADH dehydrogenase and cytochrome oxidase complex, NADH dehydrogenase and ATP synthase. So inner mitochondrial membrane possesses 5 complexes, if you remember. Complex 5 is connected with ATP synthesis, that is F0 F1 particle. Then complex 1 to 4 are involved in electron transport. Like first one is NADHQ. NADHQ reductase or NADH dehydrogenase complex. First one. Then second one is, second complex is succinate Q reductase complex. Succinate Q reductase complex. Third one is QH2 cytochrome C reductase complex. Then fourth one is cytochrome C oxidase complex. These four are from complex 1 to 4. And complex 5 is connected with ATP synthesis. That is F0 or F0 F1 particle of ATP synthesis enzyme, if you remember. Okay, so their question is 56, yes, NADH dehydrogenase and FADH2 and NADH dehydrogenase, NADH dehydrogenase and cytochrome oxidase complex, NADH dehydrogenase and ATP synthase. So they are asking complexes 1 and 4. So complexes 1 and 4 are related to NADH dehydrogenase and cytochrome oxidase complex. As per my explanation, all of 5 complexes we discussed under complex 1 and 4, this question option C comes. So it is option C, correct answer. Then Peyer's patches produce, if you remember, it is one of the secondary lymphoid organ. Peyer's patches produce mucus, lymphocytes, trypsin, enterokinase. Just now I said it is one of the secondary lymphoid tissue. Secondary lymphoid tissue means which gives space for antigen antibody reaction. Isn't it? Primary lymphoid organs are bone marrow and thymus, which produces B and T lymphocytes. Then where that lymphocytes, B and T lymphocyte, fight with antigens, that is foreign bodies, that is these areas, that is secondary lymphoid organs. What it produces? Mucus, lymphocytes, trypsin, enterokinase. That is Peyer's patches are collection of large oval lymphal tissues that are located in the mucus secreting lining of small intestine, as you all know. These lymph nodules especially are very abundant in lowest part of small intestine and empties into larger intestinal tract, which is an area of digestive system referred as ileum. You know that. The lymph structures termed Peyer's patches contain high concentration of white blood cells. So these white blood corpuscles are lymphocytes. Okay, that is, they help protect the body from infection and diseases. These are specialized lymphoid tissues in the intestine which detects, identifies the antigens such as bacteria, toxins, and mobilizes highly specialized white blood cells called B cells or B lymphocytes and T lymphocytes. You know that. So according to that, Peyer's patches are more in younger people and less prominent in age. Means young people usually will have more immunity, that we know. And as age increases, the Peyer's patches number decreases and immunity also decreases. Okay, so it should be option B, that is lymphocytes, which protects our body from antigens or diseases. Okay, then next question. How many equational divisions are necessary in the cell of onion root tip to form 128 cells? See, this is interesting question. Usually these type of questions they ask, okay, because it takes time to calculate and it is logical tricky question. How many equational divisions? Equational division means mitosis, isn't it? Equation reduction division means meiosis. How many equational divisions are necessary in an onion root tip to form 128 cells? That is, you see, in first division it becomes one cell becomes two, in second division 2 becomes 4, in third division 4 becomes 8, in fourth division 8 becomes 16, in fifth division 16 becomes 32, in sixth division 32 becomes 64, in seventh division it becomes 128. That means how many cells should be there? It takes 7 divisions. Okay, so 7 times it divides mitotically and produces 180 cells. So it should be, option should be 7. Okay, then 59th question. In human adult females, oxytocin, birth hormone, what it does? Stimulates pituitary to secrete vasopressin, causes strong uterine contractions during parturition. It is secreted by anterior pituitary, stimulates growth of mammary glands. You know that in human adult female, oxytocin is a hormone released by pituitary gland. Released by pituitary gland. That is, that part is called neurohypophysis. You know, there are two parts, adenohypophysis and neurohypophysis. So neurohypophysis of pituitary gland releases oxytocin that causes contraction of uterus. You know, during delivery, you have learned that process called fetal ejection. It is asking to share this again. Okay, we were discussing. Okay, we were discussing this. Okay, that is option B. Then, in sweet pea, genes C and P are necessary for color in flowers. Okay, the flowers are white in the absence of either or both of the genes. What will be the percentage of colored flowers in the offspring of the cross? Capital C, small p versus small c, capital P. Understand the question. In sweet pea, genes C and P are necessary for color. That means when C and P both are there, it produces color in the flower. The flowers are white in the absence of either of both of the genes. Means if C and P are not there, then it will be white in color. What is the percentage of colored flowers in the offsprings of cross? They gave cross. C, small p versus c, small p. Now you can cross. This is a dihybrid cross. You know that. That is C, small p. Okay. That is a white color flower. Because you know when C and P both are there, then only it will be colored. Otherwise, it is white. Here only capital C is there. P is not there. Capital P is not there. So it is white. What about its other partner? Small c, capital P, small p. Here also, both capital C and P should be there for color. Here only capital P is there. So it is white. So both are white. Now cross. C, small p versus c, capital P, small p. So the gametes are capital C, small p, small c, small p, one side gametes. I repeat, capital C, small c, small p, one side gamete. Okay, and other side gamete is small c, capital P, small c, small p. Okay, slight difference is there. Then when you cross, what you get? First one you get C, capital P, small p, which is colored because see it has both the letters C, capital P, both are there, so it is colored. Then second one, C, capital P, small p, that is white because only capital P is there, C is not there, so it is white. Then next, C, small p, which is white because only capital C is there, no capital P. Both are required for colored. Only one is there, so it is white. Okay, so last one. Small c, small p. As both capital C, capital P are not there, so it is white. So here, out of four offsprings, three are white and one colored. So the ratio should be one colored and three white. That is 25% of the colored flowers and remaining 75%, it is white color. That means out of 100%, if you consider 25% is one part, then only one colored and remaining three parts are white. So it should be 25% colored flowers. You can work it out. I have already worked it out here. Okay, based on my my result only I am saying this. Okay, so that is, it should be 25% of the offsprings, that is option B. Okay, then next, question number 61. India has two hot spots, Northeast Himalayas and Western Ghats, which are rich in, hot spots means, you know, forest they are talking about, which is rich in biodiversity. More number of organisms like plants and animals, microorganisms are more here. So two hotspots are there in Northeast Himalayas and Western Ghats, which are rich in what? Some mammals, swallow-tailed butterflies, amphibians, reptiles, some mammals, butterflies and flowering plants, or only reptiles. Why it is famous? It is option C. Because it has a lot of biodiversity. That is amphibians, reptiles, some mammals, butterflies and reptiles. It was there in the textbook itself. I had explained in the theory part also, even in the synopsis also, if you remember. It will have amphibians, reptiles, some mammals, butterflies and flowering plants. So it has rich in biodiversity. So it should be option C. Then loss of energy as one proceeds from one trophic level to next higher level is approximately what percentage? Understand the question. I repeat, the loss of energy as one proceeds from one trophic level to the next higher trophic level is approximately what? 30%, 40%, 60%, 90%. So it should be 90%. Can you guess why? As per 10% law, as per 10% law, he says only 10% energy is transferred from one trophic level to other trophic level, isn't it? When 10% is removed from 100, then what remains is 90%. Okay. Only 10% is transferred from one trophic level to other trophic level as per 10% law. Then remaining 90% is wasted, isn't it? Energy is wasted. So that is loss of energy, 90%. And gain of energy from one trophic level to other trophic level is 10%. So it should be, loss should be 90%. So it should be option D. Then question number 63. Mottled chlorosis on the leaves occurred due to deficiency of, you know, chlorosis, mottled chlorosis means colored patches you see on the leaf, especially the number of chlorophyll pigments will be less, or because chlorophyll pigment production is disturbed, which element, which mineral element controls the deficiency of chlorophyll pigments? That is mottled chlorosis, spotted leaves, some parts green and some parts yellow or white in color. That is because usually it is because of potassium. Okay. Potassium is macro element. Plant requires it in large quantity, which is required in large amounts by the plants. And the potassium is required for process of respiration and photosynthesis. Definitely, when that word photosynthesis is there, then chlorophyll pigments are directly related. That means if potassium is less, then chlorophyll pigments production is less, then photosynthesis also decreases. Then potassium is activator for many enzymes. More than 40 enzymes are activated by potassium. And it plays very important role in movement of stomata also. Opening and closing of stomata is also because of K+, potassium, you know. And deficiency of it causes mottled chlorosis of leaves. That means mottled chlorosis means less number of chlorophyll pigments are produced, or death of chlorophyll pigments. Then deficiency of potassium also causes plant growth remains stunted, means you know stunted growth with the shortening of internodes. Very less distance between the internodes will be formed. Definitely mottled chlorosis is because of deficiency of potassium. Okay, then okay, then what about nitrogen and all? What about what I was saying? Nitrogen. Okay, nitrogen deficiency causes yellow leaves because it can't produce chlorophyll. Okay, yellow leaves is produced. Then what are you saying? Then what about sulfur? Sulfur is required for amino acid production. Like two sulfur containing amino acids are there, if you remember, that is cysteine and methionine. Okay, two amino acids are produced by what I was saying, sulfur. Okay, what about nitrogen? Nitrogen is a heavy element. It is required for deficiency causes yellow leaves because chlorophyll pigment is not produced. Okay, then what I was saying, next question number 64. Choose the correct sequence of air pollution and its components with the effect it produces. Okay, choose the correct one. Chemical factory releases NO2, causes ozone hole. Is it correct? Automobile exhaust releases N2O, produces greenhouse effect. Heavy industry produces carbon dioxide, which results in acid rain. NOx gases produces SPAN. Okay, then produces photochemical smog according to you, which is correct sequence there. It should be D, isn't it? That is the major reason for source which depletes ozone hole is chlorofluorocarbon and also aerosols. Carbon dioxide is major gas responsible for greenhouse effect. Acid rain is caused due to oxides of sulfur and nitrogen. So it should be option D. Okay, then which one of the following cellular parts is correctly described? Thylakoids is related to flattened membranous sacs forming a grana of chloroplast. Then centrioles is a site for RNA synthesis. Ribosomes are synthesis of those chloroplasts that are larger, 80s, while those in cytoplasm are smaller, 70s. Then lysosomes are optimally active at pH of about 8.5. So which is correct according to you? It should be option A, isn't it? Because thylakoids, we know thylakoids present in the chloroplast contains a bunch of structures, flattened disc, that each disc is called thylakoid, isn't it? Together it forms a bundle. When many thylakoids together forms a bundle called grana. Okay, so it should be option A. Then question number 66. In nodulous plants, leg hemoglobin helps in what? The nitrogen cycle when you discussed in the first year. Nodulous plant, leg hemoglobin helps in scavenging oxygen, cofactor of nitrogenase, help in reduction of nitrogen and energy supplier. If you remember, what is the answer? That is, what I was saying? Question number 66, isn't it? Yeah, it should be option A, isn't it? Scavenging oxygen. Leg hemoglobin is required for carrying the oxygen. So leg hemoglobin is a carrier of oxygen. It supplies to the plant. Okay, that is, we'll take example. Like rhizobium is nitrogen fixing bacteria, which is present in root nodules of legumes. The roots of legumes secrete chemical attractants. It produces chemical attractants called flavonoids and betaines, or you can say betaines. BETAINES, flavonoids and betaines. Then bacteria collect over root hairs, release NOD factors, NOD. Last class we discussed NOD genes meant for nitrogen fixation, NOD factors that causes curling of root hairs around the bacteria. Then degradation of cell wall, formation of an infection thread enclosing bacteria. The infected cortical cells differentiate and start dividing. Then the infected cortical cells differentiate and start dividing. It produces swelling of nodules and infected cell enlarge. The bacteria stop dividing to form irregular polyhedral structures called bacteroids. The host cells develop a pinkish colored pigment, that is nothing but leg hemoglobin. Okay, the host cells produces pinkish pigment, that is like hemoglobin, which is an oxygen scavenger, means oxygen carrier, which protects nitrogenase from oxygen. Okay, nitrogenase enzyme, which is required for nitrogen fixation, is sensitive to oxygen. So oxygen is carried by leg hemoglobin. Symbiotic nitrogen fixation requires cooperation of NOD genes of legumes, NOD, NIF, fix genes. All these are nitrogen fixing bacteria. Okay, nitrogen fixing genes. So it should be option A. Okay, scavenging of oxygen. Remember this. Leg hemoglobin function is, it's a carrier of oxygen, scavenging oxygen. Okay, question number 67. Acquiring an oxygen depth is evidence that oxygen cannot be stored in tissues. Aerobic respiration is more complex than glycolysis. Lactic acid can be converted into glycogen. Then anaerobic processes are slower than aerobic processes. Which is correct? 67. It should be option A. Why it is option A? Because oxygen depth is nothing but it's a physiological state by vigorous exercise. Okay, in which lungs cannot supply all the oxygen that muscles need. You know, some people do a lot of quick exercises. Or else you think a person is running. Okay, what oxygen he takes, that is not at all enough for his muscles. Because when a person is doing vigorous exercise, vigorous means too much workouts he does, then what oxygen is supplied to his muscles, okay, is not at all enough. Whatever oxygen muscle demands, that much oxygen body cannot provide. Okay, so in that case, what happens? That is nothing but oxygen depth. Okay, so in other words, lungs and bloodstream pumped by heart cannot supply sufficient oxygen for aerobic respiration in the muscles. So in that situation, muscle cannot continue to break down glucose and release energy in a short time using anaerobic respiration. Okay, the partial breakdown produces lactic acid. You know this. Aerobic and anaerobic respiration, first year we have discussed. In presence of oxygen, what happens? In presence of oxygen, glucose is broken and it is converted to pyruvic acid, which is 3-carbon compound. Then pyruvic acid, if oxygen is present in the mitochondria, it produces 3 products. That is carbon dioxide plus energy plus carbon dioxide, energy and water. Okay, so that is how energy is released. But if in the muscles, that also we have learned, in our muscles, when oxygen is not there, when oxygen is not supplied, or oxygen supplied is very less, then glucose breaks into pyruvic acid, then pyruvic breaks into lactic acid, then energy is released. Okay, so that means it should be option A, that is oxygen cannot be stored in the tissues. Okay, then question number 68. In high yielding hybrid crop varieties, to exploit hybrid vigor, the farmers need to purchase fresh hybrid seed every year, because this, if you remember, we have discussed in second chapter. In high yielding crop varieties, to exploit hybrid vigor, do you know what is hybrid vigor? It is also called, hybrid vigor is also called heterosis. Heterosis, so many times we discussed. Hybrid vigor means, suppose two plants are crossed, okay? When two plants having two different characters are crossed, then you get one plant, that is called hybrid plant, you know. Okay, like, we'll take example. There are two mango trees, okay? Plant A and plant B. Plant A produces more number of fruits, but it gets disease. It is not disease resistant. But plant B is disease resistant. It doesn't get any disease, but produces less number of fruits, okay? Both of them have their own advantage and disadvantages. That is, plant A produces more number of fruits, that is advantage, but it gets disease, that is disadvantage. Plant B doesn't get any disease, that is advantage, but it produces less number of fruits, that is disadvantage. What happens when we cross these two A and B plants? Then it produces one plant, that is hybrid. What we expect is, it should have characters of both the plants, okay? Then, if that hybrid plant has characters better than both the parents, then it is called hybrid vigor. Okay, I had given you that example in the class also, if you remember. Like, Arjuna, okay, Arjuna has a very good talent. Okay, so, but his own son, Babruvahana, okay, he is better than his father. Okay, that means if a offspring produced will be having better characters than both the parents, like, I'll give you example, okay, like son or daughter are better than both the parents, father and mother, then what we call hybrid vigor. Okay, so what is that they are saying? Why farmers should buy hybrid seed every year? Options: it is cheaper to purchase fresh seed, or hybrid vigor is lost due to inbreeding depression, or they are not allowed to grow their own seed, or government has accepted Dunkel's proposals. Okay, Dunkel says that hybrid seeds should be purchased every year, because its character doesn't remain, hybrid vigor doesn't remain in the seed itself for so many days. I mean, more than 1 year, if you use it, it will develop into plant, but the characters, what is there in the hybrid, may not be there in the offsprings. So what is that he say? What is the option then? Correct option? It should be option B. Hybrid vigor is lost due to inbreeding depression. Means, you know, hybrid seeds only continuously, if you use generation after generation, it loses its capacity of having characters of both the parents. That will reduce. It becomes a normal plant after 2-3 generations. So better to use hybrid seeds only every time. Okay, so it should be option B. So we have discussed 68 questions, but totally we have to discuss 90 questions, which is 360 marks, half of that NEET paper. So one more part is there in, that is, this is part 4. Next part, part 5, I'll finish this paper, okay? So please see my videos. Thank you.